Good morning.
Good morning.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Good for you. All right. The only announcements I do have are if you would like to participate in Holy Communion after the service in the chapel, please raise your hands. Okay, thank you. Are there any announcements? Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Evening, morning, and noon, I cry out in distress.
And he hears my voice.
Cast your cares on the Lord, and he will sustain you. He will never let a righteous fall.
Glory
be to the Father,
and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the
beginning,
is now, and will
be.
Our psalm today is Psalm 125. Those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be moved, but abides forever. As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people from this time forth and forevermore. For the scepter of wickedness shall not rest on the land allotted to the righteous, lest the righteous stretch out their hands to do wrong. Do good, O Lord, to those who are good, and to those who are upright in their hearts. But those who turn aside to their crooked ways, the Lord will lead away with evildoers. Peace be upon Israel. This is the reading of the psalm. O Lord, have mercy on us.
O Christ,
O Lord, have mercy on us. Our reading from Matthew is from the 13th chapter, beginning at verse 44. Please stand. The kingdom of heaven is like a measure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls, who on finding one pearl of great value went, sold all that he had, and bought it. And Jesus said, "Have you understood all these things?" And the disciples said to him, "Yes." This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. I don't know about you, but no, I think I do know about you. This pandemic has thrown a monkey wrench into everything. It really has. And for me, on a very small personal note, I missed my baseball. I don't know about you, but I love baseball. Years ago, when I was a kid, and that was many years ago, my dad love the Cubs. I don't know if you are any Cubs fans out there, but they were pretty rabid.
Pretty rabid.
And my dad went crazy when they lost, and they usually did. Back in the 60s, early 70s. Usually did. And so I decided, and I didn't really have a team. And my dad always wanted me to like the Cubs, see? And so I can't like the Cubs. My dad's always yelling. You know, scared of us kids half to death when they lost, especially when they struck out or when. Anyway, I decided to pick a team that I could really, really like. So I really got into the baseball teams and said, who was winning the World Series? And guess what? Guess who I picked?
You're just sitting there. Hello? Yeah. The Yankees, of course.
Yes.
Oh my gosh. I love the Yankees. Oh my gosh. It was
like amazing. You know, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64. Always in the World Series. Great team. Super team. And my heroes. If you remember the teams of the 60s, remember Mickey Mantle? Nod your head. You know, you remember that.
Yogi Berra.
Yep, absolutely. You know, the lineup for the Yanks in 1960 World Series was Moose Scarron on first base, Enos Country Slaughter in left, Mickey Mantle in right, Roger Maris in center, Cleve Boyer on third. Oh my gosh. Bobby Richardson at short. Bob Turley on the mound. And who was the catcher? You remember? Yogi Berra. Absolutely. Gosh, I love Yogi. You know, Yogi had...
He was a master of stating the
obvious. If you remember him, he always had these euphemisms he would use. Like, for example, it ain't over till it's over. Or it ain't over till the fat lady sings. It's like deja vu all over again.
50%
of baseball
is 90% mental.
And then my favorite of all is what? When you come to a fork in the road, take it. Well, what do? You know, you go either right or left. And man, for Yogi, it's how you did it. It was all a matter of how you did it. Albert Einstein, and you know that name, of course, he would
draw out his
schematics, and he put his formulas on
the blackboard. But before he ever started, in the lower
right-hand corner, he would write 1 + 1 = 2. And then he'd write below that, do not erase. And every one of his lectures, that's what he would write. And so the message for us is very clear. That for Albert Einstein it was, you know, for all his brilliance and excellence and science, my gosh, he boiled it down to the very simplest things.
Never lose sight of the truth. 1 + 1 = 2.
Always 2.
In our gospel this morning, we're pretty short, actually.
I shortened it for you, because I didn't want to spend a lot of time on the rest of it.
But this is very important. Jesus speaks
in parables. Now, in our Bible study this morning,
we talked about what a parable was.
Parables confused the Jews.
They confused the disciples. But for the Jews, it finally offended them to the point where that's one of the reasons why Jesus was crucified. And if you look at verse 51, Jesus would turn to the 12 at that point and ask, "Do you understand this?" And their answer was, "Yes." But they were confused before that, yes. So I'd like to discover a little bit about why the change of heart. Why would they do that? If you note in the two readings I just read, the only one that was there always was the merchant, or the man in the first one, and the merchant in the second. He buys and he sells fine jewelry. The man finds jewels and riches on his property, covers it over, and then buys it. And for the one who found the pearl, that was important to him, because pearls back in those days, well, that was the stuff. That was the wealth. Gold was not the most incredible thing they could have. It was pearls. And it's all about the money for both of them. Until one day, the day comes when the most perfect and beautiful pearl was found. And for the other guy, it was when the riches were found on his property. And I like what Jesus says in the parable. They went and sold everything and bought it. It's always about the purchase in the pearl, of the pearl, and that kind of leaves us hanging. And you ought to ask yourself, what does this mean for us? Because it's about the buying, not the selling. And the most amazing part of this story is this. The merchant sold all that he had to buy it. He didn't open his piggy bank. He didn't go to a savings account and draw the money out. He didn't ask his friends to chip in. He didn't go to the bank and get a loan on his house. He didn't even sell the kids. He did steal the kids' toys. Because he's become a buyer. And more than that, an owner. So captivated is the man, and so captivated is the buyer of the pearl. He's willing to make his very life in order to possess them. You know, there's something pretty appealing to us who believe in Jesus as Lord about an allegorical interpretation. Because it's always simple. It's cut and dried. And once someone gives you the key and you know what the story is all about, then you know. Then you know exactly what stands for right. You can take that knowledge to the bank. Is that right? No. There's scant evidence in the Bible that Jesus meant any of his parables as allegories. And if there's one thing that the gospel writers say again and again and again and again about the parables is that they're very hard to understand. They're hard for us to digest. They were hard for the first generation of disciples. And they're hard for you and I today. And so the purpose of the parables is to kind of set us off balance, to get us kind of confused about where we're going in faith. Kind of moving out of our theological comfort zone. Shake up the very way we think about the stories that Jesus gives us. So in these parables, Jesus never claims that the pearl or even the wealthy, the jewels and stuff buried, symbolizes heaven. And oftentimes we look at that and say, yeah, it does, but it's not true. What he actually says is this: the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant or that man in the first part of our parable in search of fine pearls. And if you were strictly following an allegorical method, you'd have to say the kingdom of heaven is the merchant, not the pearl, and there's no sense to that. And what Jesus is saying is this:
If you want
to sense the nearness of the kingdom of God in your own lives, which is already breaking into this world in that time,
you've got to do as the merchant did.
You can't just sit and do nothing.
You can't have business as usual.
And as we well know, when this pandemic ever ends, the whole church thing is going to be different.
We're not going to go
back to what we think is normal.
Everything will be different.
So this parable really touches us at the very stuff of our lives.
It's not
business as usual
anymore. You got to get up, go into the world,
and search the kingdom out. Examine every pearl that you see. Note its beauty, its symmetry.
And the more
you come to know what that pearl really is,
you will recall the good things that God has become. The more
you will cheerfully give up
everything else
just to have what God offers us. That's what the parable will do for you.
It opens
our eyes to the spiritual truth that we might not ever see otherwise.
The parable helps us to understand
that life
in the kingdom of
God gives us a whole new perspective on what's valuable.
Used it.
So they are pretty hopeful, actually.
I think I'm pretty optimistic. The church is God's
church.
The church as we know it today is God's
church. Will be different, absolutely.
Come on.
It already is. But not just for this congregation
alone, but for the whole of the church.
God calls us
to use every single
resource that we have, every talent, every method that we have to share the good news. That's what the call is to us
here
in this place, to share the good news. If we don't do that, there'll be nobody out there sitting there if we don't step up to the plate. But always remember, especially remember what Einstein did when he wrote out his plan, his symbols, his calculations. Right at the bottom, 1 + 1 = 2. Do not erase. And together, as God's people, we can lift up Jesus Christ as the one who brings new life, true life, and grace, eternal life.
To
those of us who believe, don't ever erase that thought. Amen.
Amen.
And may the peace of God, which passes all our understanding, keep your minds and our hearts. Christ Jesus, our Lord.
Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in
heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those
who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Lord, we pray for the beauty of this church, for all it represents in this community. We praise you. We thank you, Lord, for this great nation that we live in, and we just celebrated 244 years yesterday. We thank you for the gift of the United States of America and its freedoms for all who live here. And gracious God, we thank you for the beauty of the earth that we live on. Now increase in us the sense and the spirit and the strength to preserve all beauty and to expand that into all the benefits for all. Help us to make the common life, our common life, generous. File down the sharpest hostilities. Smooth the rougher aggressions. Increase in us all tolerance and flexibility and humor. Remind us always of the graciousness of your Holy Spirit, so that we will benefit from it and will not carelessly spoil it for others. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we cannot put out the sun, but we can obstruct its radiance, throwing others into our shadow. So move us over when we monopolize your grace. Show us how to help place everybody in the full light of your love. Lord, in your mercy. Put metal in our wills to firm us for those difficult charges and attitude and opinion and program, an approach which may be necessary if all are to appreciate the beauty of this land, the beauty of the church, and especially, Lord, the beauty of the earth. We pray now for those in our hearts before you, those who are in need of your care and your blessing. And we name all these in our hearts before you. Lord, in your mercy. And we pray in the name of the Savior of the world, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May Almighty God bless and keep you. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.